Welcome to Memorial United Methodist Church's digital worship here on this first Sunday of Advent. We are so excited to be worshiping with you today, and we hope that you are excited to hear from the Lord as well. Today, as we worship, we want you to fully engage in the service. Light candles when we light candles. Pass the peace when we pass the peace. Say prayers. Tell us that you're here. You could do most of this in our comment section. If you're watching now live on YouTube or even later on YouTube, you can open up the comment feature on the side and comment. Let us know you're here. Pass the peace when that time comes. Put your prayer requests there. Engage in with your thoughtful questions or your comments. Let us know that you are here. Participating in our life with Christ is what we are all about here at Memorial. As we worship today, we will be in prayer for you and, of course, our world, and we invite you to continue to engage with us in worship.
The light of the world came down into darkness to brighten our lives and the whole world with love. So this morning, as we welcome that light into our midst, I invite you to get your candle and light it as I light this one. Come, light of the world, be with us as we worship today. And similarly, every Sunday, and this Sunday is no different, even though it is a special Sunday, we offer the peace of Christ to one another. And so this morning I say to you, may the peace of our Lord be with you this day and throughout this Advent season.
First scripture reading today is from Isaiah 9, 2 through 7. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in the land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. You have multiplied the nation, you have increased its joy. They rejoice before you as with joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. For the yoke of their burden and the bar across their shoulders, the rod of their oppressor, you have broken as on the day of Midian. For all the boots of the tramping warriors and all the garments rolled in blood shall be burned as fuel for the fire. For a child has been born for us, a son given to us. Authority rests upon his shoulders, and he is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. His authority shall grow continually, and there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and with righteousness. From this time onwards and forevermore, the zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
God of hope, who spoke words of promise through the prophets long ago, speak hope into our hearts today as we patiently wait for your Son, Jesus, through whom every promise is yes. Amen.
Light a candle bright and tall, for the hope within our world, hope that heard the ages call, as the stars and planets whirled. Shine within our hearts today, come, O hope, to us we pray.
We plow the fields and scatter the good seed on the land, but it is fed and watered by God's almighty hand. sends the snow in winter, the warmth to swell the grain, the breezes and the sunshine, and soft, refreshing rain.
Time now for our affirmation of faith, where we get to actively participate and join in saying out loud what we believe. Let us say the words together. They will appear on the screen. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Hi, everybody. In today's sermon, Pastor Carrie is going to talk to us about hope and the first Sunday of Advent. And I know we're thinking, what is Advent? What does that mean, Miss Sarah? Well, okay, kids. Advent is a faith-based way for us to focus on Jesus through the month of December and all of the Christmas activities. It's a way for us to remember Jesus's birth and keep our focus on Jesus in this very busy time. So there's lots of different ways that we can celebrate Advent with our families. We can use Advent calendars or Advent wreaths, or you could read with your parents. You could read devotionals, or you'll read Bible verses about Jesus's birth and the things that come before Jesus' birth, and of course, his birth in the manger, and then after. There's a lot of ways that we can celebrate Jesus through the whole month of December and his birth, and keep our focus on him, as this is what this special time is meant for. And that's what Advent does for us as Christians. It helps us keep our focus on our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Will you pray with me? Dear God, thank you for loving us. Thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ. And thank you for the season of Advent, so we can remember the true meaning of Christmas and the hope that it gives us all. In your Son's name we pray. Amen. And now we want to find out how we can live on our calling memorial with just three things.
I want to thank each and every one of you who brought in gift cards for the United Methodist Children's Home this year. I'll have a grand total of all those gift cards soon. But until then, I wanted to remind you about another way that we can make love show up for our area children this Christmas. The Christmas Family Fund is something we've worked with for many years, and each year there seems to be more and more need. The Barnabas Center and some local organizations refer names to memorial of area students whose families could use a little extra help at the holidays. Many of these students are youth who fall through the cracks of other helping organizations. Through the Memorial Christmas Family Fund, we are able to make Christmas joyful and wonderful for some children and families who might not be expecting a very happy Christmas this year. What better way is there to make love show up in our community this Christmas? To make a contribution to the Christmas Family Fund, please designate Christmas Family Fund on the memo portion of your check, and then our memorial elves will take care of the rest. Now, you've heard me mention many times about what's going on December 11th. That's the morning of our Christmas cantata at our 8 o'clock and 11 a.m. services. Between the two cantatas, we'll have the alternative Christmas mission fair and potluck breakfast in Maxwell Hall. Now, since you know all that, you also know that a wonderful way to live out your calling through memorial is not only to engage in the wonderful worship, music, and mission that we'll see that morning, but also to bring a friend or neighbor along. The cantata is always a wonderful opportunity for people to experience the Christmas story through music and the gospels. And then the mission fair is a way that we live out those gospels by supporting our neighbors through so many wonderful helping organizations. It's a perfect Sunday to bring a friend with you to hear the good news and then see ways you can live that good news out through our missions. So start inviting your friends now. Remember, that's December 11th for the cantata and mission fair. And the wait is over. Our Advent study is about to begin this week. This Wednesday, November 30th, our pastors will begin leading a special study on the book, The Angels of Christmas, by Reverend Susan Robb. This wonderful study will look at the messages of the angels in the Bible and how they still have deep meaning for us today. Join us live on Facebook for an interactive study, the four Wednesdays of Advent, that's November 30th, December 7th, 14th, and 21st, at 6:45 p.m. I'll also post a recording of each session to YouTube right after they finish, and you can view them there anytime. Have you gotten your books yet? Books are in the worship spaces in the Partner Center, or you can order them from your favorite bookseller. So go ahead and start reading those books now. And join us on Facebook this Wednesday, November 30th at 6:45, or anytime after on YouTube. Making Christmas bright for our area children and youth through the Christmas Family Fund. Inviting a friend to hear the good news and see ways to live out that good news through the cantata and the mission fair, and growing through our Advent study. These are just three things you can do to live your calling through memorial.
As we collect our offering today, I want to take a moment to just remember and be thankful for all that God has done in our lives. Here in the United States of America, we're finishing the week of Thanksgiving, if you're watching this today on the first Sunday of Advent. And so many of us have spent time remembering and being thankful for the things in our lives. Today, as we're talking and learning about real-world Advent and what does it mean to have biblical hope, we can be thankful for the ways that God is working in our lives. Whether it's through a neighbor or a friend or a family member, whether it's through connecting with a digital service where you are, God is actively at work in our lives. And the act of our offering, whether it be financial or whether it be giving in service to others, is saying thank you to God back for all of the things that God has done. So as you give today, we encourage you to give using our website, numconline.com/give, and that will walk you through the whole process. But I'm going to say a prayer now for our offering. I invite you to join with me. Let's pray. God, we are so grateful for all of the ways that you work in our lives. There are too numerous to count. Bless this offering that we receive to do your work in this kingdom. And God, as you receive this, we ask that you feel it as a thank you for you working in our lives. In your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, church. Will you join me in prayer? Lord of light, hear our prayers today. You, O God, whose holy light illuminates the world and the darkest corners of our hearts, please draw near to us on this day of hope, this first day of Advent. God, help us to be as little children, filled with wonder, joy, and great anticipation as we remember from today to Christmas morn, your story and song through familiar tradition, scripture readings and celebrations, this old and wondrous story of your great love for us that was manifest so long ago in the coming of your Son and our Savior Jesus as a tiny and helpless baby. Help us to have hope and not despair for a future that is brighter than that Christmas star of wonder and light. Help us, God, on each day of this Advent season to look to you as the perfect gift, surpassing all others in every way, as the light in our darkness, as the light that shows us the path you would have us follow. Jesus, your way is the way that leads to life, love, and peace. You tell us that. Your ways are the path to true happiness. So give us wisdom, God, to follow you and none other. Help us to not be distracted by the ways of the world that would have us overindulge, overconsume, and forget to keep our eyes on you, the author and finisher of our faith. For you are the true reason for every celebratory event in this Advent season. Help us especially, Lord, to remember those who have neither the means nor the hope to celebrate, and who look upon those with plenty, with longing eyes and hearts, at a door that is closed to them, in a place with no room for them. Help us to be the ones to open that door and offer your hope, offer your love, and offer that one thing they most long for that will bring light into their darkness. Lord, give us your peace, that we and those we love don't need the things of this season as much as we all need love, acceptance, and presence in our lives. Keep us from feeling anxious or inadequate and from comparing ourselves with the images we see around us that would tell us falsely that we are not good enough. Help us to see your light as the only gift that is needful in this Advent season for ourselves and for others. Help us to be the comforting presence for those who will be lonely and sad because they have lost loved ones who once made this season joyful. Help us to understand, blessed Lord, that faith is the reality of what we hope for, the proof of what we don't see, and strengthen our faith so as to expand our hope in you as we pray the prayer that Jesus taught us, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
second scripture reading today will be Colossians 1, 3 through 14. In our prayers for you, we always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love that you have for all the saints because of the land laid up for you in heaven. You have heard of this hope before in the word of the truth, the gospel that has come to you. Just as it is bearing fruit and growing in the whole world, so it has been bearing fruit among yourselves from the day you heard it and truly comprehended the grace of God. This is learned from Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant. He is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf, and he has made known to us your love in the Spirit. For this reason, since the day we heard it, we have not ceased praying for you and asking that you be filled with the knowledge of God's will in all spiritual wisdom and understanding, so that you may lead lives worthy of the Lord, fully pleasing to him, as you bear fruit in every good work, as you grow in the knowledge of God. May you be made strong with all the strength that comes from his glorious power, and may you be prepared to endure everything with patience, while joyfully giving thanks to the Father, who has enabled us to share in the inheritance of the saints in the light. He has rescued us from the power of darkness and transferred us in the kingdom of his beloved Son, in whom we have redemption, the forgiveness of sins, the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Today, as we start our sermon moment today, I brought this glass. This is a glass of lemonade. I love lemonade, and I hope that you do too. But I wanted to start today asking just a simple question. When you look at this glass of lemonade, do you see it as half empty or half full? I really think I just brought the lemonade so that I could sip it as we work. But I want you to see it. Half empty or half full. If you're a half kind of full person, people would often call you an optimist, right? Where you can live with this moment of expectation of pouring more lemonade into the glass. Maybe you sweeten it just a little bit or not enough, but you have this air of expectation. You look at this glass and you think, I can't wait for there to be more lemonade in it. Or if you look at this glass and you're one of those half empty people, you may say, that glass, she's drinking it down. It's gonna be gone soon. We just know that this is gonna happen. There's nothing we can do about it. This half empty. And the world might call you a pessimist. Now, I think most pessimists would be a little bit offended by this. I think they might just call themselves realists, looking at the real world. But there are two ways of being in the world today. We could certainly be both of them at the same time. For many of us, we are both optimists and pessimists, or realists. It just kind of depends on the time and the space and the situation. But the question I have for you today is not about optimism or pessimism. It's about how would God want us to be in the world? What would God expect us of our behavior? I think that pessimism is not something that Christians often succumb to because for a simple fact that we profess to believe in a God who created us and defeated death with the resurrection. It's hard to be a pessimist all of the time as our worldview with that in mind. That doesn't mean we don't have moments of pessimism. But we can't live only in optimism either, because optimism can often come out of a place of naivety, ignoring the actual world around us. Artificial optimism can be born out of a people's desire to see goodwill come to every situation. They can only survive if more lemonade is coming. And I'm not sure how this is that God would want us to operate either, because it leaves out and up to question a lot of difficult life circumstances. So if neither half full or half empty attitudes are exactly right, what does God have for us today? What is hope in this world of biblical hope? We get a hint from this in our passage from Colossians. The writer of Colossians, which some say is Paul, and some say it happened after Paul, but was written with Paul in mind, the writer of Colossians says in the opening, in this verse, "In our prayer for you, we will always thank God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, for we have heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love that you have for all saints, because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. You have heard of this hope before in the world of in the word of truth, the gospel that has come to you." So Paul, though never meeting the Colossians, writes to them to encourage and correct them. And he begins his communication in a similar way that he begins all of his communications, with a prayer of thanksgiving. For the Colossians, Paul is encouraged by their faith, for their love of all people, and hope. In fact, he uses this word hope 3 times in the first chapter. Hope laid up in heaven. Hope before in the world of truth, the gospel that has come to you. Hope is what we're all about here today. For it is the first Sunday of Advent where people around the world are talking about this idea of hope and what is hope. And so I want to look at this concept, and more importantly, I want to think, how does the Bible define hope? But before we get there, 3 years ago, we hired a video company to make a series of videos for Advent. And these videos looked at what hope, love, joy, and peace meant to our children. And today is a special treat. I wanted to play the video about hope so we could see what some of our children's thoughts about hope were, or at least what they were 3 years ago. Let's watch.
Do it over here, and you and I.
What do you think? That's a tough one. Mm-hmm. Yeah. What do you think hope means?
Hope, like, I don't know how to put it into words.
I don't know.
Thankful.
Hope means where you really want something. For Christmas, I hope for a hoverboard.
I'm hoping for the American girl, Logan.
And Alexa.
I hope for a guinea pig.
Yeah.
Because I have 2 pets, or actually 3 pets, 2 dogs and a cat that would usually, like, I guess, hunt down and maybe, like, eat a guinea pig or something. But I've always wanted a guinea pig. Yeah, I hope for a guinea pig.
Hope means to say I can do it in your brain.
Hope is when you want something to happen. I hope that my grandma gets better.
Hope means, like, I hope no one is lonely or something on Christmas.
Like having hope in somebody, like you really, really want.
I hope that I can finish 2nd grade.
I hope for a good Friendsgiving tomorrow at my school.
To see my cousins over Thanksgiving.
I hope that my grandparents are coming down for Thanksgiving on Tuesday because my grandma and grandpa are coming down.
Yeah, do you love your grandma and grandpa?
Hope to these cuties was toys, and it was Christmas, and it was family visiting. This anticipation and excitement certainly does define hope for many people. But it is hope in a thing, a toy, or a new pet, or hope for a visit at Christmas or Thanksgiving, hope for a sick relative to feel better. Many of us are familiar with this kind of hope. We might hope for a good parking space when we get to church. We might hope for no traffic as we drive through Yulee or wherever you live. We might hope for a raise at work or a peaceful night at home. In this way, hope and optimism are very similar. This kind of optimistic hope is choosing to look at any situation and choosing to see how the good can come from it. This is a good thing. It is a good thing to live with expectation, and excitement is a basic human reaction. It's good for our souls. However, it is ultimately fleeting and not sustaining. The things that we hope for, will eventually break or wear out, like many of the toys that the kids hoped for just 3 years ago. We all know that we can hope for family to visit and peaceful nights at home, but they will not always happen. We can also see where optimism will not sustain us always through difficult times. In fact, think back over the last several years. There are many life situations and world situations that leave no room for optimism. School shootings, people dying from COVID, death from war, starvation, and I could go on and on and on. We can see situations like this and think, where is God? How am I to hope? I am too weary to hope. This feeling is understandable. But before we hang our heads and give in to this overwhelming fear of weariness, I want to look back at our passage from Isaiah that we read at the top of our service today and see if within that we can catch a glimmer of biblical hope. If you remember your Old Testament prophet history that we learned earlier this summer, if you've been with us, you will remember that Isaiah was a prophet about halfway through the kingdom period of Israelite history. When he came onto the scene, there had been about 250 years where kings had come and gone from the throne, and for the most part, many of them were not such good kings, and neither were their people. They had turned their backs on God and the covenant that the Israelites had made with God. When we open our passage today, Isaiah is talking in verse 1, which we'll put on the screen now, about a time period in history that was recorded in 2 Kings chapter 15, when Assyria, the opposing kingdom, came into the Israelite area of Galilee and destroyed it. Not only did they destroy it, but they took all of their people, the children, the aunts, the uncles, the moms, the dads, the grandmas, the grandpas, all of them, and they deported them from their land. These people had gone through a terrible time, as Isaiah is beginning to prophesy, being ripped from their homes, taken from their families, and their lives destroyed. And Isaiah 9, chapter 2, describes it like a light being turned off in their lives, the people who walked in great darkness. And then it says, those who have lived in a land of deep darkness, as if someone came into their life and just turned the light switch off. And it goes on and it says I begin to think that they're wondering, where is God in all of this darkness? Why did God abandon us? I'm sure they are praying and wondering, why does God not seem to hear their prayers? The passage continues to go on to say in verse 4, of there being a burden as heavy as a yoke. A yoke being that U-shaped object that connects horses or cattle as they pull a trailer, that this is how heavy their burden is. And so in this bit of prophetic poetry that Isaiah is describing, these people have this heaviness. Can you feel that heaviness? Have you ever felt it before? And you may be wondering, I thought we were going to talk about hope, Pastor Carrie, about biblical hope. And I'm glad that you asked that, because I would say I actually already gave you a glimmer of this hope. Did you catch it? Let's put verse 2 back on the screen. The people who walked in darkness have seen a great light. Those who lived in the land of deep darkness, on them light has shined. This prophetic poetry that Isaiah has written says that the people, they did walk in darkness. This is a fact. But that they have seen a great light. That those in deep darkness, that a light is going to be turned on for them. And you keep reading, verse 3, it says, you have been multiplied and you have increased in joy. They rejoice before you as the joy at the harvest, as people exult when dividing plunder. Can you picture these people who have gathered a large harvest? And now they're dividing up all of their spoils, the joy on their faces. Through verse 4 and 5, you can see this happiness building as you read this prophetic poetry. And yet the prophet has still not told us. Okay, Isaiah, you can say, we know there are this people that are walking now in darkness, and you're telling us that a light is coming, that it will be more joyful, but how and what and where do we see that? And then Isaiah gets to this climactic verses of 6 and 7, ones that if you have been in the church for many years, or even just 1 year, you have heard this passage before at Christmas time. It says, "For a child has been born to us, a son given to us, and authority rests upon his shoulder. He is named Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. Great will be his authority. And there shall be endless peace for the throne of David and his kingdom. He will establish and uphold it with justice and righteousness for this time onward and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will do this." This is it. Isaiah says that light that will be turned back on, the joy that they will feel, will come in the form of a child being born, a son that will become to be known Everlasting Father and Mighty God, and authority will rest solely on his shoulders. We learn about this child that he will come and his reign will bring endless peace, and it will establish and how to hold up with justice and righteousness for all people of all time. This is the glimmer of hope that we're looking for. The hope when things seem bleak and mild, when the lights are turned out and the yoke of burden is heavy. Now, what those people didn't know that we know now is that child that Isaiah is talking about was who? Who was it? Jesus. Of course it was Jesus. Christians for years and years have been reading this passage and knew that it pointed back to Jesus, that hope that Isaiah prophesied about did come 700 years later, but it came. In fact, near the very same place that the Assyrians plundered and deported all of the people, in that same place, the child did come. In doing my research for today's sermon, I came upon a series on biblical hope by Tim Mackey, who's the creator of the Bible Project, which by far is the best, hands down, Christian education resource that I know. But in reflecting on this biblical hope, he makes this statement. Biblical hope is based on a person, which makes it different from optimism. Optimism is about choosing to see in any situation how circumstances could work out for the best. But biblical hope isn't focused on circumstances. In fact, hopeful people in the Bible often recognize that there's no evidence that things will get better, but you choose hope anyway. The people in Isaiah's time and throughout the Old Testament modeled this biblical hope. Yes, there, of course, are complaints and petitions for their situations to get better, and that is fine and good. We have those as well, and that will never stop. But there was a level of hope that ran deeper, a biblical hope, a constant rhythmic reminder of a practice of remembering all that God had done in their lives and the promise that God would always be with them. Throughout the scriptures, if we have read them, people come up on hardships, or they have trouble in their lives, and a person stops the narrative and reminds the people all that God has done for them. This happens over and over and over as early back in as Genesis. And this continues throughout all of scripture to today. This rhythmic reminder of God's ever-present nature is followed by the people of God putting their trust and their hope in who God was, is, and promises to be, as opposed to putting their hope in their circumstances. And this continues into the New Testament. When the gospel writer told the story of Jesus' ministry, you can tell that he had in mind Isaiah chapter 9, because in fact, he quotes from it in chapter 4, verses 15 and 16, reminding the people that God, through Isaiah, had promised them a child who would be mighty God among them. And Matthew is helping the people remember that God is with them now. This biblical hope, this pointing to who God is and how God is working in our lives, continues throughout the New Testament and into our passage from Colossians today. I brought it full circle for you. In our passage today, the first 14 verses, hope is mentioned twice. We'll put those back on the screen. Hope being laid up in heaven and hope from the world of truth, the gospel that has come to you. These ideas that hope is bigger than our lives and who we are. And then later, I told you it happened one more time in chapter 1, verse 27, where it's described as Christ living in you, the hope of glory. This hope, this word biblical hope, is looking to God as an ever-present movement in our lives and in our world, even when it is hard to see. Hope is acknowledging that the same Jesus that was prophesied long ago and was born 700 years later is the same one to die on the cross for us and then defeating death, raised for us again. This hope is biblical hope. But what do we do with that for today? How do we have hope for today when our world can be so bleak? Here in this state, we live in a place where two tropical storms have hit our borders in just less than a month. People have lost everything, many including their lives. And we here on Amelia Island and in Yulee can say thank you because for the most part, the storm passed us by. But what about the people that are dealing with grief not far from here, who are spending their holidays rebuilding their lives? Where is God to them? Or where is God when during this season when teenagers are getting unfair health diagnoses and where people are suffering from mental illness? The list goes on and on and on. Where is hope? How do we have hope, this biblical view of hope, in this real world? We are calling this Advent season, this series, a real world Advent. And today we want to talk about how do we have real world hope. And I want to close today by telling you one story. A story about real world hope that happened here just last week. We have a women's circle in our church that noticed many months ago the needs of the hungry in our community. They have this righteousness and justice burning in them, and they wanted to do something. And they decided that with lots of months of planning and prep and building, that they would set up a little pantry outside of our office building in the parking lot by our playground, where it can be seen by all. And they filled it with food, and it sat waiting on a sign to tell the world that it was free for anyone who needed it. And as it waited, Hurricane Ian rolled in, and it took down the pantry and all of the food that was in it, gone. And for a moment, I am sure that there was these thoughts in these women's minds of, where is God? I can imagine that they're saying, God, we put this up for you and your people. Why did it have to go? Why did you do this? Why did you not protect the pantry that was doing good? And then maybe they were wondering, well, should we even put it back up? What if there's another storm? What are we going to do then? But that group of women, with their eyes pointed to biblical hope and the call that God had placed in their lives to care for the hungry in our neighborhood, they put it back up and they began to make plans to fill it with food again. But before they could, I got a phone call. On Sunday afternoon, I got a text from a church member, Matthew Fry, asking if anyone could put food in the food pantry, or was there anyone scheduled to do that? And I said, yes, of course, anybody can put it in there. And my thought was, well, maybe he had a little bit in his car and he was going to just put it in there. Little did I know that as he dropped his son off here at the church for one of our kids' programs, he went straight to Walmart that afternoon. And he says he walked up and down the aisles of Walmart putting food into his cart. And a woman stopped him in the store, and she struck up a conversation about the food that he was buying and asked him if he was going to eat all of this shelf-stable food, because there was quite a lot in his cart. And he told her about the little food pantry here at our property. And she commented how amazing that was, and then off she went. Matthew continued on about his shopping, and a little while later, as he was filling his cart, she came up to him again. And this time, she had a $20 bill in her hand. She gave it to Matthew and she said, use this to buy some of the food. As Matthew left the store that day, he got in his car and he immediately called me. He said, I just have to tell someone what happened. He relayed this story to me and I could hear the excitement in his voice about the entire encounter. He told me in that phone call that he went to the store that day to fill the pantry after hearing Justin and the youth group talking about participating in a recent weekend where they focused on learning about food insecurity and hunger. He was inspired to do something, to embody hope in our community. Friends, this whole event, from beginning to end, the idea of the food pantry to encountering the woman at the Walmart, is all how God is working among us. God didn't cause Hurricane Ian to take away the food pantry. No, but God worked through the circle, through Matthew, through the youth group and the woman in Walmart to show us all an example of God at work among us. Life will be hard. We can never avoid that. But God will show us every single time that God is with us. Emmanuel, a word you hear a lot at Advent, in fact means God with us. Jesus came to teach us about life, to teach us to care for others, to be his hands and feet here in our world. And each and every time we embody God where we are, where we embody God's hope and light in the darkness, we are bringing biblical hope to the people around us. We are remembering all that God has done for us, and we are proclaiming that for the world to see. So as you go on with your day today, I want you to be thinking about real world hope. And I want you to be thinking about, how is God working in your lives? How is God showing you that God is there even in the most difficult of times? And how can you point other people to God's real world hope here today? Because the world may be bleak and it may feel dark, but God is here with us. And we, you and me, can have hope in that. Amen. Another way that we actively participate in our worship service here in the digital community is with some questions. I already gave you a hint of those questions at the end of the sermon, and we're going to put them back on the screen for you, and I encourage you to take some time now to reflect on these for your own life. Worship today has been such a joy, this first Sunday of Advent, where we have prayed and we have laughed and we have learned and we have experienced God's joy and God's hope. Today, as we engage in Advent for this month, we're encouraging our community to begin to record these moments where God is breaking into our real world, where you see God in action in our real world. So we've created a hashtag real world Advent. And each week, as we discuss hope and joy and love and peace, we want you to be commenting in your social media about the ways that you see God at work in your life. If you use the hashtag real world Advent or hashtag real world hope based on your story, we will get to see those and share those with our community as well. Passing on these stories of God's interaction in our world is part of our call to pushing forward biblical view of hope. So as you go from worship today, know that God is working in your life, that God is Emmanuel with us, now, forever, and always. In the name of God, the Father, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.